I'm Agis of Antonio, and I'm the CEO of a company called Cognizant. So we are based in Belgium, already 2.5 years, relatively new, but with quite some adventure. So we are 15 engineers. I would say that we are AI-driven software integrators in the sense that we combine knowledge engineering, semantic technologies, linked data. Recently, you will find us in iCup Incubator because we have started very discreetly to do some machine learning adventures with the University of Brussels. Our projects the last 2.5 years are around the labor market, the legislation. These are the two cases that I'm going to show later on. And we have started to experiment quite strongly on digital badges based on the open badges and electronic portfolios, and with some future, let's say, wishes for blockchain technologies, which is quite a high plate. Industry perspective, I chose this heavy word to differentiate ourselves from research data. So whether they are production-based or whatever you might call it, we are not going to show things that have to do with research data. We are going to talk about linked data and open data that are applied in production-ready systems. Unfortunately, or fortunately, the private sector is not very keen on open data. So industry here, don't expect any manufacturing data and stuff like that. We are going to talk about problems. But before doing that, and in order to prepare my story, let's say, in a better way, this is something, this is a photo and diagram that I use quite a lot, which shows that what amount of data is produced per minute. So 4 million views on YouTube, for 500,000 Twitter feeds and so on. And the question is, while data is the king, open data is not such a good non-relative. This is the open data barometer, which shows with the red areas where data is really closed, with the green area where data is really open. So it's quite interesting to see that despite the fact that there is a huge quantity of data generated every minute, a very small percentage, as you're going to see in the next slide, is really open. If I would have prepared the slides after the first presentations today, I would have been even more transparent because the guys gave me a lot of hooks today, whether from the Open Data Portal, the European Data Portal, or especially the Data Journal. This reminds me of the old days, but that's another discussion. What I want to point out is that there are many, many criteria where you can say that my data is very open, not open and all this stuff. We focus on the two principles that already exist. The one is from the Open Data Charter, quite some years ago, and a relatively new one, 2016 there, which was in the G20, I think, if I call correct, in Shenzhou, in China in 2016. What these two principles say that in the end, okay, open by default, of course, it's not rocket science, but comprehensive according to the Open Data Charter. And if you see the fair, findable, accessible, reusable, interoperable, and this is the criterion that we are going to use throughout the presentation to show how fair are our open data. Findable and available. Okay, in 2015, Open Data Barometer showed that from the quantity of data available online, only a small percent, 10%, or around 12% was really open. The now arrow shows the new report that has just been published, where you see that the open data has decreased, the openness has decreased 7%, the machine readability has decreased 53%, while the good thing, of course, is that there is a 26% on top of the openly licensed, which means that the barrier of using the proper open license is getting better and better. Accessible and usable, I'm just quoting the barometer, 73% of the data sets were relatively easy to find. 10% of all data sets we surveyed were not available free of charge. Only 25% of the data sets we analyzed were available under an open license. meaning licensing remains a big barrier for that use. Interoperability, something that we believe in, something that is not very easy to implement, because interoperability stems out of many, many criteria. But institutions are producing more information which is encoded in forms that are preventing data publishers and public users from communicating with one another. You need data to communicate. If the data is not interoperable, how can you communicate? Reusability. Fixture, they are out here from what I saw. Very nice report, which shows that the technologies are still an obstacle. Well, if you see how much effort is typically required to make your data reusable, a lot of effort and some effort. So you see, it's already quite a lot. And reusability, data is published in many forms, from cadastral maps to interactive bubble charts. But you cannot use a bubble chart as a user of the data, can you? We're going to show, without marketing ourselves, but just very pragmatic things, and I'm going to be quite fast because there's quite a lot of work that has been done the last 2.5 years out of these use cases. There are people, there are project managers of CodeZone, architects and developers. You can start asking them to touch whatever you want. So we have two very interesting projects that we worked the last 2.5 years. The legislative data in Luxembourg, which is basically open data. It's quite interesting ecosystem. And opening up the qualification data in Europe, which I'm going to describe in the next 10-15 minutes. Open data sets about legislation, by the way, according to the barometer, you see, legislation, machine readability 14%, bulk uploads 66%. The best thing to show what we have done in order to not to go without to make the red color green. An ecosystem of applications in the government of Luxembourg. We have not developed everything, but we have developed quite a big part of it. Two basic distinctions. Backend applications that support portals. The backend complicated stuff, from URIs to linked data, taxonomies, ontologies, which must be transparent according to that very, very interesting data journalist said that must be transparent from the end user. So these backend applications support the portals that are more user-friendly, but developers need flexible APIs, developers need endpoints, Spartan endpoints, if we get a little bit technical here, and also developers need to know about the control vocabularies, which we call here authority tables and so on. So an amalgamation, an aggregation, a very nice supporting ecosystem of backend and frontend applications. And of course with some annotators here, because you always need to do annotation, whether it is syntactic or semantic. The frontend portals, the goal was to open web applications to visualize and discover all sorts of Luxembourgish legislation. So facilitate the exchange of Luxembourg legislation information between different stakeholders within the country, but also across Europe. The backend applications manage different pieces of the legislation by relevant ministries and organizations. So it's not one ministry, it's not one organization, it's let's say a set of various stakeholders around legislation. Facilitate the encoding of legislative data for internal and open data usage. Share the information across different organizations. When we hear the word share, we of course come up with ontologies, and there is a very interesting ontology that provides this sharing, provides the metadata, provides the richness, provides the labeling, and all the stuff to do a very nice query on top of Elasticsearch and stuff like that. The second case was and still is a little bit trickier because it has involves a lot of politics, because it has to do with the member states. It's not only one country. Even one country is difficult, but when you start in 24 or 26 countries, it's getting a little bit more complicated. What was the idea? What is the idea of the European Commission? There are national qualification databases that host metadata or data about qualifications and certifications of every country, every member state of Europe. The EQF, the European Qualification Framework, wants to more or less try to align the levels of these certifications. But how can you align when there are many countries, many players, and when there are different semantics between? So what would have been the best idea is, first of all, to convince the member states to open up their databases. But OK, opening up a SQL database doesn't make sense unless you are divided and so on. So opening up the databases, semantifying them, whether you choose the word anglify, scossify, whatever, and then start harvesting the metadata, the result. The result were two tangible things that we have developed the last 2.5 years, a metadata schema that describes everything around qualifications, from the provenance side, who is issuing, from the accreditation side, who is accrediting, from the context and content side, what are the building blocks of a qualification and certification, and some parts of the workflow and so on. Once this common language, let's say, has been established, some crosswalks with other existing schemata, some really very, in a very good situated countries were done, then a register of registers, let's say, or a qualification that a register was implemented, is implemented, so that it hosts the metadata of these qualifications. The idea, not hosting the qualifications per se, but having a very powerful search engine, first of all, to search the data go to the national qualification database that is opened. And secondly, to help the member states to publish their own datasets, should they have not finished with their qualification database implementation, or because they just wanted to make some data publishing available quite soon. Third goal was to support the existing portals of the European Commission that have to do with qualifications and skills and jobs and occupations, basically the ESCO and the LOQ. LOQ stands for Learning Opportunities and Qualifications Portal. The idea was still is quite simple. There are providers of qualifications, the member states, then the private awarding bodies as well, of course, and there are consumers. In this case, the consumers are the two portals of the European Commission. So an API, which can just publish, let's say, the data sets to the portal, but of course this can be extended, this can be expanded into providing search and user search functionalities. In the core, the QDR, the qualification data set register, standardized data by using standardized technical formats, whether they are JSON, XML, RDF, or whatever is supported at this moment. There are validations. There are validations. We have started, fortunately, as of even last year, to use Shuttle, which is quite interesting as a recommendation from the W3C. And of course, something very, very important, missing in our opinion, not from these projects, but by versioning. So data catalogs, DCATs, application profiles, or other extensions of the DCAT, let's say, notion are very, very fundamental for data publishers to start using in order to have versioning. Challenging. We went to the member states the last 2 years. We visited 15. I'm not putting any flags, not that this is a problem. Everything you have to see the glass half full. But there were some challenges regarding the level of technology, the level of understanding. We found that some countries were way ahead of what we could ever dream. We can talk during lunch. But we found some countries that, well, they were a little bit behind this. So we had to prepare. We were quite proactive, I must say, with the help of the Commission. Basically, there we have to proactive a lot of training, documentation, slides, webinars, whatever you can imagine in order to foster, let's say, the outcome. So we found countries that were already familiarized with linked open data software, and we were fabricated, as the English would say. We found also countries that were not that far, but they had already created a centralized identifier schema, for example. So we could do a crosswalk, we could do mapping with the qualification and the data schema, and that was really super. Well, for marketing reasons, I would say that we didn't have challenges, but of course we have. Everyone has challenges. But the truth is that in our case of Luxembourg, we only had some challenges which we were expecting and that made us not feel bored. Technology. Not understanding, because we are 16, 17 years developing, let's say, RDF pipelines. But, for example, there were challenges like legacy data that we had that had to be transformed. So scripting here, scripting there, aggregates here, aggregates there, stuff, which of course is a challenge, but it's a nice challenge for nerdish people. On the other project, on the second project, we had more, let's say, the understanding of technology as a sort of a barrier. The implication that opening data meant and means, which is very, very important to understand and see how officials from the member states are either very positive or quite reluctant to open up the data. All these 2.5 years, the projects that we have done, the lessons learned is that indeed, guys, don't publish HTML and PDFs if you really are fostering reusability of data. That's not rocket science. But please add metadata so that you can make the data comprehensive and thus interoperable. Make them findable. Put intuitive links, whether they are existing schemata like schema.org or just some simple metadata that you define in a control vocabulary and publish the control vocabulary so that the people understand. Don't take and transport around your datasets without updating the URLs. Encode them in URIs. There is some stability, I would say, so that you can make them accessible. And use licenses. Really use licenses, I might say, 3 times. But the most important is try to also start implement license conflict mechanisms. I was also personally surprised last year when I found out that markup languages that in theory could handle or tools can be built on top of them exist already for around 10 years now. We believe we have seen it, we have implemented it. We believe that open standards and technology stacks are mature. Whether Sparkle, the new version, or link data fragments, or stuff like that, are successful or not, these things work. So use them. And I left, in the end, 2 very important things also. There were hooks this morning about quality of open data. Even if, which is not very regular, I find the datasets open there to implement my use cases and my workflow, well, which is not very complicated, let's suppose that we find it, the quality, the completeness, the schema, let's say compliance, or stuff like that are not in there. There are now some quality assurance frameworks. There is one from a researcher from AKSW in Germany, Zaberi, who has really implemented a very, very, let's say, A to Z quality framework. We should start using it. Last but not least, whether the EIF and the EIDAS and the solution architecture templates of the European Commission sometimes are a little bit difficult to read, they provide a very, very nice first roadmap for interoperability. ESA is working now already quite a lot of years. Let's help them by providing feedback. This is where it all started, as you saw. So that's all. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for finishing a little bit ahead of schedule. So that leaves some time for questions. If you're in. Yes.
In the legislative sector, what vocabularies are emerging as standard now?
from the typical vocabularies like Dublin Core, for example, and, well, we used quite a lot of the ISAC Core vocabularies, for example.
For legislative?
For legislative, because legislative, is, I mean, the ISAC Core vocabularies are quite generic. They're talking about location, they're talking about service, stuff like that. Then we used some other vocabularies, but still, you know, XML is around. So some accommodation stuff like that, they are already in there. There were a variety of vocabularies. I don't remember if the word SCOS was used. I think there was a sort of a parsing vocabulary of Cosmos, which I mentioned, RDF, of course, and all this stuff.
For the text itself?
In the
mean? You know, to structure the paragraph, the idea, the references.
Then you have to look at the publication office.
Yes.
The publication office has a full ontology for the
text. Next word.
Okay.
What level are you linking the multilingual aspect? In the versioning or somewhere else?
Ah, that's a good question. I have to consult a possible guy. Nathan, can you?
For Luxembourg, it's mainly French.
So, for Luxembourg, it's mainly French at this moment. But for the other, if there is a multilingual linking, this, in theory, should be linked.
You saw one layer which was version, yeah?
Yes.
And there you have the editing facilities. But I thought that there you had also the link for the multilingual, because this is fundamental.
Yes, the multilingual, in the sense that if there are different language, let's say, data, the same data set is in different languages, yeah. Then what we use is the so-called language packs, for example. Yeah. And then every language pack is a different data set. And then the multilinguality is linked on the versioning level. On the DCAT level. So because this is a different data set, it's not the same data set, we split them.
Because you understand clearly, if you have something that works on the terms, this will be very slow.
Depends.
From term to term, yeah. Because you have so many terms, you have to...
Yes, it depends also on the way that you structure your taxonomy, your SCOS taxonomy on the terms, right? I mean, the alternative labels, for example, it's how you structure also your taxonomy. And what do you put in memory and all the stuff, I guess.
You have a model somewhere?
Yes, there are quite a lot of models.
Yeah, what, on the website or?
For ESCO, yes, it is on the website, and everything is open, so we can provide you.
Okay. So you looked at 15 different member states, right? But did you only look at the national level, or did you also look at different levels below that?
The region, what do you mean?
For example, or city?
Well, for example, in Italy, the regional is quite complicated. There are 21 regions that are behaving like 21 countries. So there, whether we like it or not, we had to address the regional also. Maybe in Belgium also there are some regions. So, of course, needs to be on a national level. Doesn't work on a national level in all the countries. So we had also to address the regional level.
So how were they linked then to each other?
The regions, for
yes.
example. Well, not a lot of linking, in the sense that in Italy, for example, I have a very recent example. They have implemented their qualification database, which it's called Atlante. They have as an ambition to foster Atlante throughout all the 21 regions. But from what I know, so far it's been heavily used by the Piemonte region, from the Romana region, and three others I don't remember. So it's an ongoing thing.
I saw three hands going up at the same time in the back, so.
I was going to add before the answer the question. The thing is that in every country, even if they have more regions, they need to link the national qualifications framework. It's mandatory for them to link those qualifications to those levels. So if you take the case of Belgium, for example, there are three national qualifications, like one for Flanders, one for French-speaking part of Belgium, and one for the German part of Belgium. So those institutions that are running notifications, they need to link those notifications to one of those specific frameworks, and then those notifications are assembled at national or regional level, depending on the framework, basically, and then we retrieve those information from those databases. But there is no, even if there are regional qualification frameworks, they are not directly related to the national qualification framework, and the qualification are not on the table for them.
as we have one more session before lunch, I would suggest that if you have any other questions, you'd yeah. Unless it's very short.
I will be around.
It's very short.
Yeah.
2 weeks ago, at a meeting organized by the Flemish region, Jean-François Juncker has announced that there will be a new European regulation imposing that once an information is available in one public institution anywhere in any country, the other public administration will not be allowed to re-ask the question to the citizen, but they will have to make up themselves how to find the information inside the public.
Once and only principle, if I recall correctly. Once and only principle.
Yes, that's it. Do you see any link between that and open data?
Absolutely. Absolutely, and I would say I see a link with this, with linked open data. Maybe I'm playing with words, but
okay.
This is the reality. Yeah. Okay. Absolutely, capital letters.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.